Welcome to Fabulous Fifties and Beyond. I'm Jim Pollard, your co-host with my wife, Jeanetta. And today we're going to be talking about a conference coming up Wednesday, May the 30th. And it's about pandemic flu and other emergencies. And it has to do with older adults, and with disabilities, people with disabilities. You stay tuned and we'll be right back.
And he'd say, go with what you got. Start from where you are. Give it your best shot. Keep reaching for that star. Get in the race. Keep your own pace. Keep moving and never stop. Just go.
Go.
It go with what you got.
I'm Jim Pollard with my wife Jeanetta, and today we're going to talk about preparedness. How prepared are you in your home for any type of disaster emergency? We're going to talk primarily about the pandemic flu threat, and it seems to be a real threat because there's a lot of time and money and being spent on it. Our guest today is Tina Massengill, and she is the trainer for, how many counties are you?
13.
So you do Purchase and Pinerol then, don't you?
Mm-hmm. And then a little bit of the counties on the other side of the river also.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I think first let's talk about this conference that's coming up on Wednesday, May the 30th. Who can participate in this conference?
Anyone who wants to can participate in the conference. We're really encouraging senior citizens to come. Anyone who maybe is a caregiver for senior citizens or for disabled people, this would be a great conference to come to get more aware of what the plans are and how you need to be preparing at home.
It is something that we need to be looking at, isn't it?
Yes.
I know I have, I've talked with some of the educators and different ones, and they aren't even beginning to get ready.
Well, I think it's kind of like, everybody used to prepare for the nuclear bomb to be dropped.
Right.
You know,
yes.
And I've seen all of the old show, commercials where the kids were running for the bomb shelters. And I know of even people who actually dug shelters and did things. And even though that never happened, the fact that we were prepared for it was the smart thing to do. Anyone can look back over history and realize that money was well spent because it could have happened. And the same thing is the pandemic flu. I hope and pray that it doesn't happen, but I think realistically we have to be prepared. And if we're prepared, then it won't be as bad as if we just were, pretending to be, ostriches with our heads stuck in the ground and not doing anything in preparation for it.
And the thing is, whether it's the flu or it could be something else.
Yeah.
It could be anything. They say one day we may have an earthquake here.
Right.
Or whatever.
Right. And it's basically the same type of preparation.
Right.
Pan flu, the thing about it is that it will be so much longer, the duration time for that we'll have to be prepared for and dealing with it. Whereas opposed to, the earthquake, we mainly tell people to be prepared to take care of themselves for, 3 days by themselves. Now, where we are, the truth is you really need to be more prepared to take care of yourself for about a week. Just because when the big earthquake happens, if it ever does or when it does, it's going to be massive, and it will not only affect Kentucky, but it'll be that whole line of states from here up to the, Great Lakes, basically, and we'll all be affected. So that'll be a lot more time for people to come in and get to us. So when you think about Katrina and you keep thinking, everybody was like, why can't we get down there and help them, It's going to basically be the same thing if we have an earthquake here. It's just going to take time because there will be such a massive amount of people affected to get the supplies in that we need. So that's the reason why we need to be prepared at home so that we can take care of ourselves. And then when everybody arrives, it'll be great. We'll be here and we'll be ready for them to come help us.
I was at a Red Cross Disaster Preparedness meeting several years ago, and they brought up something that I had never thought about, that if a big earthquake hits, Paducah and this area will become like an island if it knocks all the bridges out. I had never thought about that we are pretty well surrounded by water, and an earthquake situation like that, and that makes getting help here even more difficult.
Exactly, yes.
And that was quite interesting for me to think about that. So this conference, and of course, like we said, we've kind of looked over the schedule and what's going to be going on. But it's really aimed at older persons.
Yes, people who need a little extra help taking care of themselves. And a lot of seniors are going to fall in that. You know, if they were cut off from the outside world for a little while, could they survive and take care of themselves? Now, I believe most of our seniors are so resilient, they might be in better shape than our younger population is.
That's true.
I'm thinking they've got the canned green beans, they're okay, because yeah. I'm going to grandma's house if something happens myself. But, you know, the truth is, we come and listen and see what's going on so that you can better prepare and know what you need to do. Do you need to, you know, keep a supply of canned goods? And how would you deal with it? Do you have your deep freeze full? And is that a good thing to have ready to go? What would you do? I think this is going to be an excellent conference. And for people who are caregivers to the elderly or to people who are low functioning or disabled, this is a good thing for them to come and look at too, because they need to get prepared. One of the biggest issues will be, I think our seniors, their ability to survive, I think is fantastic. Like I said, I think they might be in better shape than some of our younger generation for knowing how to take care of themselves. But what will really be their issue is their medicine.
Right, right.
Yes.
You know, so there are some really special needs that our older population and those who are on a lot of medication, they need to be thinking about. And this will be a great opportunity for them to listen and think.
And I discovered something. We finished up our Christmas season and was headed for Florida. So I looked at my blood pressure medicine and I realized, yes, I had probably a 2-week supply, but I would need it more before I got back. So I called the pharmacist to get it fulfilled, and they said, we can't fill it now. And I said, even though it was a 30-day refill, every 30 uh-huh. days, they could not, I was too close to the last one, they couldn't refill it, my blood pressure medicine. So I thought, wow, you know, if we're talking about a situation like that, that's one of the things that I hope they'll address in this conference. I guess you got to get your doctor to write a different script.
A different script, or there is a way, I've talked to some people where there's a way that a lot of times you can hit it just right. Like, no, they're not going to give it to you 2 weeks in advance.
Yeah.
But they might give it to you 2 days ahead. You know, there's a time period. Well, if you went ahead and picked it up a couple of days ahead and you did that for several months, then you might have
a few days extra
put back.
But that was really amazing. Now, I knew I could get it in Florida
right.
where I was going to be there, but I was just going to save myself the trouble mm-hmm. of having to have it go down there and then have it come back.
Right.
But that was an eye-opener to me, just that one thing. And that's all I take. I, you know, these people that take 4 or 5 or 6 a day,
mm-hmm.
that's another thing for them.
Right.
But this was quite an eye-opener on that. Because if we talk about the pandemic flu, which is what we're talking about, and for those of you who are not familiar with the word pandemic, we're talking about the bird flu. That's the common terminology for it. And that's the one that they use on TV and everything like that. Uh-huh. And some of, I don't know if any of our audience are old enough to remember, was it the 1919 flu? Is
yes.
that the date it was, I think? The pneumonia and the flu that came up the Mississippi and killed a lot of people. And that's the model that a lot of the health agencies are looking back at, isn't it?
Right. Yes, correct. And what we're doing is we're trying to figure out, some communities were affected greater than other communities.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And basically from a public health stand, what we've realized is it was the communities that limited their social interaction. Those communities had less people affected. And if the pandemic flu comes around, that's what we'll be looking at. Basically, pandemic flu, what that means is every season we have a flu that comes around. Every season we have the flu shot that we basically, about 10 months before flu season, the scientists who know more than I do, look at everything and they say, this is more than likely the strand of the flu that's going to go around. And at that point in time, they start making a vaccine to where if you take this shot, you're less likely to get the flu or to be affected severely by it. So that's what we do every year. Now, pan flu is a flu that will sneak up on us that we won't be prepared for. And when that happens, we will not have a vaccine that will take care of it. And it will be a severe flu. And the problem with, you know, everybody's like, well, then you'll just make one really quickly.
Mm-hmm.
But
it doesn't happen that way.
No, it is at least a 10-month process of making the flu vaccine the way they make it. And what they do is they make it in eggs. actually. That's the reason why if you're allergic to eggs, you don't take the vaccine. And so that's one, what the issue is really going to be. There will be this flu coming, and it'll be just like any other flu. The thing will be not to catch it, you know, and you will do that by lessening your contact with other people and by making sure you have really good hand washings and that kind of thing. And that's what we'll be looking at. And from the flu that hit back in the 1900s, the early 1900s you're talking about, that's what they saw. Those communities that realized it was coming early and started limiting their social interaction and making sure that people were hand washing and food preparation, being really cautious that way. That's really what lessened the severity in some communities.
Okay, we brought them to the clift. Uh-huh. So now we're going to take a break.
Okay, great.
And we'll bring in our nutritionist, and she and Jeanetta will get together and they'll talk about nutrition. And as I say a lot of times, I avoid those sessions because my nutrition is not what Pam recommends. So you stay tuned. Pam and Jeanetta are going to talk to us about nutrition now. We'll be back.
We welcome Pam Ward back today. Pam is a registered dietitian at Western Baptist Hospital. And she comes to share with us each week. And so we welcome you today, Pam.
I'm glad to be here.
What are we going to be talking about today?
Today I want to talk about caffeine, because there are very few people I know that don't consume caffeine. And we don't really think about whether it harms our health, whether it's good for us. Some of us use it as a pick-me-up, you know, because it will kind of increase your energy level. But there are other aspects to it, too, that need to be considered.
So, and most of us are caffeine addicted.
Most of us are caffeine, you know, are caffeine nuts. In fact, the last statistics I saw said approximately 70% of Americans consider themselves hooked on coffee. And that doesn't take into account the people like me. I don't drink coffee, but I love diet soft drinks, you know. There's all sorts of other ways you can get caffeine. And of course, then there's all these new drinks like Red Bull and Tab Energy, I think, is one. And they tend to be absolutely loaded with caffeine. And that's why they help your energy level. So there's other ways other than coffee. So if we're going to say 70% drink coffee, we're probably looking at 90% that drink caffeine on a regular basis.
Yes, it's kind of an American thing, isn't it?
Oh,
And so many people think they can't get going in the morning if they don't have their caffeine.
I agree, and I must admit, this morning I had a Diet Coke that I probably could have swam in. It was that big. But we just, you know, we're used to caffeine and we like it, but we do need to think
what it does.
And caffeine is rather unique, because there are some very strong benefits, but there are some equally strong deterrents, let's say. So you have to find that fine middle road and not go overboard with it. Something I didn't realize until I started looking at this is caffeine raises blood pressure.
Really?
Yes. So if you have an issue with blood pressure anyway, you know, it's something to really think about. Now, it's a temporary increase. You know, it's not forever, but if you drink, you know, mid-morning you have something with caffeine, with your lunch you have something with caffeine, you grab an afternoon snack, you have a soft drink, each of those are going to raise your blood sugar or your blood pressure. So you're seeing a pretty consistent increase. So if hypertension is already a problem you have, you really need to think about the caffeine. About the caffeine. And it also, there's some research out there that shows that for diabetics it raises their blood sugar. And again, you know, it's not a long-term increase, but if you're a big caffeine drinker, it's going to be constant. And the statistics were pretty impressive. It was anywhere from 20 to 40% increase in blood sugar with regular caffeine consumption. It isn't that it raises blood sugar, but it interferes with insulin and how it works on blood sugar. So diabetics really need to think about the diet soft drinks. You know, now the diet caffeine free, that's a whole different story. But these that are high in caffeine, you know, they can affect your blood sugar.
You know, I really can't tell any difference at all in the taste. Can you tell a difference in
Diet soft drinks versus regular soft drinks?
I'm talking about the caffeine.
Oh, the caffeine. No, I really don't. I have some people tell me that the non-caffeine drinks, the caffeine-free, taste a little bit flat to them. But since that's primarily all I drink, you know, I don't notice any difference. It's like anything else. Once you get used to it, you're fine with it. It's just sometimes a little period there to make that change.
Of course, one of the things caffeine does is if you have a sleeping problem.
Mm-hmm. It can aggravate
right.
that. It affects affects sleep patterns. It also affects bone density, and particularly in women. And since women are more prone to osteoporosis and some of those things, again, it's something to think about.
That you need to get off of.
You need to get off of it, or at the very least,
cut back.
Cut back, because as I said, for every detrimental thing caffeine may cause, there's something positive it can cause too. Believe it or not, caffeine can increase your memory, can stimulate your memory.
Wow.
I know, I'm obviously not drinking enough.
We all need
that. Yeah, I'm not drinking enough. It also can basically improve your brain function. You know, you're gonna think a little better.
Really?
Yeah, so coffee might make you smarter, I'm not sure. It may help prevent type 2 diabetes, which is interesting because once you have diabetes, it may impact your diabetes in a negative way. But if you don't have diabetes, it has a positive effect on helping prevent that you ever develop diabetes. So we've got both ends of the spectrum there.
And that's what's so hard, is to find a balance in there.
You're right, and that's true with a lot of things as far as nutrition goes, and that's why we preach and preach and preach moderation. You know, don't
right.
go overboard with any one thing. If you are a person that drinks maybe a soda with your lunch and a soda later in the afternoon, obviously you're not going to run the risks of some of the problems as someone that drinks a pot of coffee in the morning, you know, or drinks diet soft drinks all day. So you've really just got to find that line. Caffeine has shown it may help prevent Parkinson's disease. And, you know, Parkinson's is a hard disease to treat. Medication, of course, helps tremendously, but there are all sort of dietary components that go into it, you know. But yeah, caffeine may help decrease your risk for Parkinson's.
So again, it's like everything else. There's an up and a down.
Yeah, there is an up, there is a down. And you just have to be aware, and you have to basically pick and choose what's right for you. You know, if you don't have high blood pressure, but say you have a family history of high blood pressure, you're a person that might want to think about it. Someone with type 2 diabetes might want to think about it. But it does affect just a multitude of health conditions.
Well, thank you so much for sharing with us, Pam. And we're glad to have you back today. And we'll look forward to hearing what you have to say next week. And so we will see you then.
I will be here.
Our guest today is Tina Massengill, and she's with the health department. And we're talking about preparedness for disasters, whether it's flu or whatever it is, right?
Right. Let's talk about this conference again for just a minute. It's Wednesday, May the 30th, mm-hmm. and it's going to be at the new Lindell Plantation Event Center.
Right.
Now, how do they register to get to go to this? Because it's kind of a little complicated thing, isn't it?
Preferably online. It's
yes.
on train, and I think you're going to put the website up there for them to let them know how to do that. But basically, train is a very interesting concept on its own. Train is a website that everybody are starting to post their trainings on, and it's a way for them to track trainings and everything. Public health has been using it for a while. The nice thing about train is once you go on and you register, you'll have your own ID number, and you'll have your way to register every time, your own password. After that, whenever you register for a training through Train, it will keep a track of it for you. And that's how you can go back and prove things. If you're a nurse, you can get some free CEUs. For this particular training, there's going to be nurse CEs, and there's also going to be social worker ones. So
what I did, I didn't put the train, we didn't put the train up, but
okay.
We put Vicki's telephone number up because Area Council on Aging is one that's sponsoring
yes,
it, right?
Yes, it is, yes.
And so we put the, her name and telephone number there so that they could call there.
Call her.
Yeah, right, and she'll love it.
She'd probably like that.
She'll love it, but she's the one to put me on it. As, yes. I get emails from her about, Jim, this is one thing we need to talk about, or here's one conference we need to talk about. And of course, Lori gave me your name. And
and after today, I'm going to go back and tell her thank you. No, actually, it's been really nice.
But we, you know, that's one thing we kind of, we want to know what's going on so that we can make the public aware of it. Because our thinking is that there are a lot of things out there and there are a lot of things going on that the public doesn't know about unless they're in the loop. And it's hard to get in the loop.
Yes, it is. And this is a perfect way to do it.
Yeah. And so it's not information overload. If anything, it's information underload that they have trouble finding about what's available for them. And this is a good place. I noticed the headline of people that are coming. They look like the dynamite people. Most of them coming from Frankfurt,
yes,
right?
Yes, they are.
Frankfurt and Southern Illinois, I think, right? And so we've got some good people. And it's 9 to 1:15, and lunch is provided.
Mm-hmm. Is there a fee for the conference?
No, no fee. It's free.
And so they really need to, like you say, I think it's really important if they're taking care of somebody.
Right.
That they do that. We talked also in the break about some other aspects of your job, and I think they probably need to know about those, or your position, maybe I should say. Let's be politically correct now.
Okay. Well, I am a... public health came on kind of late on. When we first say first responders, most people think of police and fire and the ambulance service as your first responders, because when you think of an accident or an incident happening, that's who you would call, and that's who would show up, and they would take charge of everything going on. In the first responder community, the public health is also a first responder. And basically what happens is, if you had a fire, well, you know the person, there's going to be fire department there, and there's also going to be police there, but the fire department's in charge. Now, if you have a hostage situation, you might have a fire truck there, you might have a police car there, and you might have an ambulance there, but who's in charge is the police, okay? So in the realm of first responders, we kind of all have these agreements of when this incident happens, this particular agency would be who's in charge, but we'll be there to help them because we are a community together. When we start looking at bioterrorist acts or pan flu, some of these natural things that can occur that are diseases basically, the health department would be the first responders. We would be the lead agency in charge, because basically we're who can get the medicine back here from CDC. We're the ones that the vaccine would come through. We're the ones that would be in charge. So as things started happening after 9/11 about how to bring first responders together as a community, how to work together to better respond to incidences, that was one of the things that came out, is that public health has to get on board and know how to help and know how to take charge if it should be an incident that falls to them. So my position was developed a little bit after 9/11, and my basic job is to make sure that I bring training to all the health departments in my communities so that they will be compliant with federal regulations, that the people will be trained to know what to do in a disaster and how to help, basically. And that's really my job.
Public health has kind of come full circle in my mind, because as I was growing up, it was not uncommon for public health to go out and put a sticker on a door and say quarantined.
Yes.
do they do that anymore, quarantine?
Very rarely.
That's what I thought.
Very rarely. They do have the legal power to do it. And I think there was a case with TB in another state to where the person absolutely would not follow what was recommended for them to do. And the health department had the jurisdiction to actually have them put in quarantine to make them stop infecting other people and take their medicine, basically. Now, most people don't realize that. Now, don't be expecting the health department to knock on your door anytime soon, because we're not going to do that. But we do have that power if it came down to
it. Well, they
used
to do it for measles and just all kinds of different things.
All kinds of things, yeah.
Scarlet fever, I think, even, and just different things that they would, if the kids got it, they'd stick a quarantine sign up on the door.
Right.
Which, there's nothing wrong with that in my book, and especially with this, talking about TB, this new strain of TB is bad.
Right. Exactly.
And if there's ever one that needs to keep somebody in that has it, that's the one. Because, mm-hmm. correct me if I'm wrong, but I understand that the new strain is the one that they really haven't developed any antibodies for, any antibiotics to really cure that thing, have they?
I'm not a nurse, so I'm not going to go into detail about
that. Okay,
but I will say, most of the times with the TB cases we've seen in this area, it is basically you need to take medication. And once you've taken so many doses of your meds, you're not to where you're going to spread the germ to other people and not contagious, basically. And so most people, we do have special TB nurses that if there are cases, they go out, they follow it up. You know, that kind of thing still goes on today, and most people aren't aware of that. But it happens all the time. We just take care of it.
Well, it's a disease that we've gone a long way in controlling,
yes,
I guess.
Yes.
It's like polio and a lot of the
fever.
Other scarlet fever.
Yeah.
You know, we've gone a long way in controlling these diseases.
Right.
And that's the ideal situation, is control.
Exactly.
Prevent and control.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to me, that's the ideal situation that we need to do. Well, I just want to do the highlights on this again, because believe it or not, we're running out of time.
Oh, wow.
But it's the conference is Wednesday, May the 30th, 9 a.m. to 1:15, and it's going to be at the Lindale Plantation Event Center in Lone Oak. That's the new event center building in Lone Oak there. It's for anybody.
Anybody, yes.
And particularly if you take care of an elderly person or something like that, or if you just need to know what you need to do to be prepared for any situation like that, you need to be able to go there. And it's no charge. And like I said, we put Vicki's number up on there, so I'm going to say that she'll have to tell them how, but she'll email them if they want to know, you know, what needs to, because this train thing, I was totally... We signed up for a conference 2 years ago, and all of a sudden I get this thing that we have credits through train. I didn't even know that's what was going to happen. But we appreciate you being here. And I think from time to time, you need to let us know if there's something we need to talk about.
Great. I appreciate
that. You
know,
if something's on the horizon, because we are under the threat of bioterrorism. That's mm-hmm. one of the things that we're under the threat of. And something we have to watch out for. The food chain and everything is just, there's so much out there that we need to watch out for today. So we appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
And sharing with us. And for our audience out there, we want to invite you to watch our show every week. We'll try to have something informative or inspirational on for you. And then we want to motivate you to get out and do something. Volunteer. Go to this conference. Learn what you can. There may be a place where you can volunteer and help out there in the community. So you watch our show every week. Jeanetta, tell them how they can get in touch with us.
Through our website, the Fabulous Fifties and Beyond.
.net.
.net. Okay. And the post office box is P.O. Box 7, Bowes, Kentucky, 42027.
And all of our shows now are being streamed on the internet. That is Paducah2, the number 2.org. So you can go to Paducah2.org, and all shows are being streamed on the internet now. Remember, use it or lose it.
Can't see as well as I used to. Can't run as far or as fast. Sometimes I think that the old me is becoming exactly that. But when I start thinking